Hello, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to do a video about role-playing. So I'm going to do it about Vampire the Requiem. And more about its launch and what went wrong for White Wolf. Some of us are old enough to have lived through it and eagerly anticipated it and had some thoughts about what went on, why it didn't hit the stride it could have done. And a lot of it, I think, is in White Wolf's control and they didn't handle it quite well. And it's a simple fact that Vampire Requiem and the reboot of the World of Darkness didn't do the commercial things that White Wolf wanted it to do. In case you didn't know, early 90s, White Wolf started a thing called World of Darkness, a shared universe by a lot of different horror factions like vampires, werewolves, mages, etc. Coming into the new millennium, they decided to kill all that, move on, and release the new World of Darkness, now called the Chronicles of Darkness and shepherded by Onyx Path. Now, I like the Requiem set of books. I'm currently one of my projects is to pick up all the Requiem books. I've had them in the past. I'm rebuilding. I'll do some other videos about Requiem. I'm not going to talk too much about Requiem, but they are lovely looking books. Hardback. Apart from the clan books, don't know why the clan books were never hardback. But anyway, let's get cracking. So in this video, I'd like to talk about the reasons why it didn't reach the heights it could have done. I'm going to be digging beyond the Masquerade was just better narrative. I mean, there will be elements of people for a Masquerade, people for a Requiem, all that sort of stuff. But what I want to do is think about the things that were happening at the time which supported the decline of White Wolf as a game and entity. I mean, I was there. I lived through the rise and fall of Vampire. I just probably started playing Vampire about 1994. And certainly by Requiem's launch in 2004, I was almost peak fan of the World of Darkness and White Wolf. At one point, I had every Vampire book up until the end of the third edition, as an example. And started off playing tabletop, but actually moved into live role-playing, and I did a lot of live role-playing. And when I say a lot, I do mean a lot. What should I say? Mind's Eye Theatre, as it's all branded. And I was pretty influential in Camarilla UK. And I was involved in running and organising some pretty large events. My particular thing I did most of was the Sabbat. So I brought the Sabbat as a playable venue into the UK. So a lot of work with that. Regional storytelling, domain storytelling, tons of stuff, tons of playing, tons of travelling, met loads of cool people. It's a really good time. I'll do some videos about probably Mind's Eye Theatre as well, because it did take a big part of my role playing life, and it's something I can talk about at length. I was there. So, 2004, summer of 2004. Launch Requiem was pretty excited. I was working away from home for the first time, so doing some training somewhere. I was kind of working away for 3 months, and I was able to pick up my copy at launch. I even got a free launch t-shirt. I tried to hunt that down, I couldn't find it. But yeah, free launch t-shirt. And because I was away from home, I spent a lot of time in the local hobby store, Traveller Manor, Newcastle as it was, the city I was working with, chatting to the staff about role-playing games, etc. It also meant that when I got my copy of the book, I had loads of time to devour the books on the night I was in the hotel book. So I jumped into it, looking forward to it, feet first, delved into it, and generally liked what I saw. And I still like the Requiem line. And I'm pretty disappointed that it declined and didn't take Vampire to the next level. I am currently enjoying Vampire the Masquerade's Resurrection as a role-playing game. And one of the reasons why I've decided to start collecting the Requiem books again is it's a pretty complete sandbox vampire game. The other thing about New World of Darkness is they did some really good books, which was just based around World of Darkness, like Mysterious Places, Ghost, really building on horror motifs, which was really good. I've always wanted to play a game set in there where just a normal human dealing with the supernatural threats and weirdness in a town. And during lockdowns, I've done a lot of walking around my local area, and as I'm walking, I'm finding new places, I'm going to all the unusual things I'm thinking about in terms of like World of Darkness, what could that be, what could it be, and I'm writing all these stories in my head. But anyway, so let's look at 2002, a long time ago, 18 years, I can't Oh, 2002. Yeah, 2004 is 18 years. 2002 is 20 years ago. Anyway, so let's look at the environment White Wolf reset their World of Darkness in. Because it wasn't just a vampire reboot, it was a whole World of Darkness. All previous material was done, moved on. Time to move on to the new. Now, in the mid to late 90s, White Wolf could barely put a foot wrong. Vampire the Masquerade was joined by werewolves, mages, changeling, wraiths, and more. It was a massive and expansive world. Each genre had loads of different clans, tribes, traditions, so players could really find niches which really appealed to them. So amongst the broad fans and players, you were almost encouraged to become ultra loyal to specific factions and sub-factions. Now, when you're going to reboot a world system, that's a big hurdle to overcome. It's not a lot you can do about that when you've created such good connections to the clans, kiths, tribes, etc. And there's an emotional connection to the old material as well that you've got to overcome if you really want to make the reboot happen. Players were rooted in the World of Darkness. Like I say, I'd been on board since 94, and when I got involved, I was a mid-teenager, so it, throughout all my kind of formative years, certainly for me, this Masquerade was so a big part of me, big part of my life, big part of my world experience. And then invested in time, books, resources, and collecting the books and lore. You know what? I'm a peak of 150 plus World of Darkness books. So there's that to overcome as well. So whatever you've got to replace it with has got to be absolute stunning and well done. I mentioned before about Mind's Eye Theatre as well. So Mind's Eye Theatre was a prime recruiting ground for White Wolf's customers and fans and getting news out way back. Looking at how companies manage social media now and thinking about how we got information back then, I'm amazed companies survived back then, to be honest. And I think about how I got information. Basically, I had to walk into a shop and talk to people or see the posters up on the wall. Anyway, so Mind's Eye Theatre were big, but we also had a big organisation called the Camarilla, and I was involved with Camarilla UK, but it was an international organisation. And I joined in 1996, and what you had was a series of interconnected local LARPs, which came together, so I could take my character from my local game, and I could take him wherever I wanted in the shared world. Could even go over to America or other places where they had games. And it was large, you know. When I joined in 96, my membership number was 307. I think we had about 1,500. Numbers went up to 1,500 or beyond. As high as what I remember. And that's all individual people who's been involved in it. That's in the UK. And that still discounts all the local independent labs, as we called it. So I lived in Darlington. There was a independent game in Middlesbrough I used to go to. Great one at Sunderland University. And these weren't small games. There were 50 plus players. 50 people in Middlesbrough wanting to turn up and engage in Vampire World of Darkness games. And Glasgow had the Camarilla game, two independent games, one of which is still running. And when COVID happens, I'm hoping to get back into LARP and GV LARP, if you want to look it up. Glasgow Vampire LARP, GV LARP is what it's called. And not being able to manage this fan group and the Mind's Eye Theatre stuff effectively was a key part of the key mistakes that White Wolf made when they rebooted the World of Darkness. So let's look at two key mistakes. First one was, you know, rebooting World of Darkness doesn't happen in 2004. Product gets launched in 2004. 2002 or earlier, all this stuff would start to be getting written. And it feels to me that White Wolf wanted to start controlling things a lot more from 2001, 2002. Perhaps a new strategy linked to this. Get some groundwork sorted out, deal with potentially negative feelings from the big live role-playing organisations first. Perhaps a new upper staff member changing, coming in, not really understanding the environment, the relationship between the two. Don't know, but something changed then. And in 2002, White Wolf and the Camarilla actually went hammer and tongs at each other. Camarilla being White Wolf's official fan group. And in 2001, White Wolf tried to take more control of the organization. Camarilla obviously fought back. There was a law got sued over the use of Camarilla, even though I think in 1998, the Camarilla organization had kind of claimed the title Camarilla for themselves. And the thing was, though, at the time, whilst the higher officers of the Camarilla was involved in all those law cases and stuff, and it didn't really affect the people on the ground, it kind of did, because a lot of the leadership, and another video is about leadership in these big role-playing organizations, it all filtered down. Personally, when I heard about it, I was all for a better and more better links with White Wolf and the Camarilla, but many of the uppers in the Camarilla was not. And this started muddying White Wolf's name. You'd go to events and there's a lot of antagonism towards White Wolf. And I can't stress enough, you know, the LARP community was massive at this time. And you were going to games and there was barely a good word to be said for White Wolf. Like I say, how we communicated back then was different as well. It was the early days of the internet, really. And yeah, I think this was something which was very badly handled by White Wolf. And actually with that as well, second big thing was the end of the lines were rubbish. Okay, Gehenna, the Red Star, all those plots, it's just rubbish. I'm not gonna dress it up. I loved a lot of stuff that White Wolf did, but the ending for The World of Darkness, as it turned out, wasn't the ending, with the V5 coming out, and Masquerade 20 was just rubbish. And we sometimes look back with rose-tinted glasses, but the final books weren't good. The legendary ending did not live up to the expectations of its players. White Wolf had provided a defined canon story and pushed things in a certain direction. I remember Justin Achille being interviewed around the time saying, yeah, when I took over for, I think he took over for Revised or set up the kind of like third ed, was like, yeah, we've been talking about this stuff, we have to do this stuff, and we'll provide a great ending. And it's like, yeah, that was just rubbish. And actually, the written tabletop ending basically provided a book with a few options you could have ran, and then the kind of out of all of that are kind of another kind of whole mage thing kind of shuffled through before that. But by the time it got there, it lost my attention. Now, during this time, the Camarilla was forced to run the end times, as it was known, and it just started hemorrhaging players as the plots imposed themselves on local games. So one of the beauties was you'd have your local game, and if you didn't want to engage with the big meta plots that was happening, you didn't have to. But these plots did, and they wormed their way into loads of local games, and it wasn't great. There was nowhere to hide from it. It was going to happen. But we also knew that something was coming to replace the World of Darkness, but it was a way off. So it was pretty grim if you wanted to wait and hang on, because you didn't know what this new thing was going to be. And what we had at the time was just, yeah, as you can see, I'm still disappointed by it. And with a new job and stuff, actually, by 2004, I was going to a couple of local games, but by 2004, I just had nothing to do with the society as a whole much. I mean, I did come back. I did start doing a lot more stuff with Requiem again, but that was in the future. But it meant the players and customers were wandering off from White Wolf for the next fix. You know, if White Wolf weren't providing them what they wanted, they're going to go and spend their time doing something else. And it wasn't going to be World of Darkness anytime soon, because they weren't providing things quick enough. The Glasgow Indie Games, as a point of reference, for example, didn't run the end times, and they still have a successful one running now. It says a lot about the end times and what it did to player bases at the time. And when I say wander off as well, this was at a time when online gaming was starting to hit up, which I might come back and cover in the future. Yeah. So let's look at the Requiem book. The Requiem book was the best-selling White Wolf book of all time. I think a lot of people put a lot of hope in this book, not just on the company, but players. Players who have been a bit disenfranchised that wanted something to connect to and get back involved. I expect some champagne was popped over that at White Wolf's office, and I suppose the shareholders and the people that make the money were delighted. I've got nothing against shareholders and people making money off great products. However, the world was rebooted to shake up sales. Sales had been plateauing for White Wolf, and authors were getting a bit stuck in the rut with stuff, so they wanted something new to challenge themselves with. And whilst this was a great spike in sales, sales very quickly fell down. A lot of this can be seen through the narrative that is told in the White Wolf documentary on The World of Darkness, which is available on Amazon Prime, if you want to kind of fact check some of the things I'm saying. So what happened was this book came out, giving you the setting. Then we were followed up by Coteries and Nomads was the releases. And I must admit, I didn't buy them. They didn't set my world alight. And I've since gone back and I've picked them up, and like all of this books, really well-written books, really enjoyable. And it didn't inspire me at the time, and I was feeling a bit burned out with Vampire. And at the time, this didn't set my world alight. One of the reasons was during this time, my primary way of enjoying Vampire was live role-playing. And whilst this came out in the summer of 2004, the Mind's Eye Theatre rules didn't come out till 2005. So during that year, at the very least, my primary way of doing Vampire was through the old world. So there's no reason for me to really get involved with these kind of books and collect them in the same way I had, because I wasn't doing Requiem. We hadn't looked at the new system. We hadn't decided what we were going to do with it. Now, in terms of business, having a big book launch 1 year and then a big book launch the next makes perfect business sense for like, but in terms of engaging and keeping a community and understanding what your customers were doing, I think White Wolf really dropped the ball. And you knew how important Mind's Eye Theatre was to White Wolf at the time, because it's actually started putting Mind's Eye Theatre character sheets in the clan books, if I seem to recall. I think a better strategy would have maybe been the core book. Then I've flipped up earlier Mythologies. Mythologies, the New World of Darkness doesn't have one vampire creation myth. It's not reliant on Cain. Mythology talks about a lot of that, you know, something that would have really piqued your interest, because this book left a lot of questions answered, which Nomads and Coteries never were going to. But something like this, whilst not answering the questions, because that's not the point of Requiem. Point of Requiem is it's more a sandbox than a prescribed story arc like Masquerade. This would have started, got you thinking about the different mythologies and creation myths and stuff. So anyway, my mind would have been core book, Mythologies, then December, launch the Mind's Eye Theatre book with a view and maybe's marketing about getting people playing in the new year. And then you could have had a big Christmas spike in sales from the core book. And you know, I'd have had some sort of campaign, New Year, New Dance Macabre. And fleshing out and bringing love to the clans. I said earlier that hopefully you've seen it yourself. You will have certain affiliations with clans and love certain clans. And some people really cleave to certain clans, and that creates a bit of loyalty within the brand. You know, fleshing out the clans, which was a key thing of why people like the World of Darkness, that's why we'll have so many of them, should have happened earlier. I don't think White Wolf actually started releasing clan books till 2008, and actually those clan books are brilliant. If you get a chance, if you've not read them, if you get a chance to read the Requiem clan books, really good. One of my biggest complaints here about Masquerade is it spends too long talking about the past in a clan book and not enough time talking about the now, whereas Requiem kind of addresses that and talks a lot about how the clan feels in different places right now. But anyway, that's for another video, I think. Cracking on. And the other thing that I think that happened as well was Requiem was new, but it wasn't that new. A lot of the key things about being a vampire still existed in it. And I've seen interviews where the developers said they wanted to go further with changes, but I had to hold it back because I didn't want to frighten people off too much. This meant people like me at the time, I look back at my journals, I keep journals and notes about stuff, indicate my thoughts were along the lines of, this looks okay, I'll play Masquerade because that's what we're doing with live action, and I've got all the books for it, and it's about as complete as it's been. Maybe it's come back to this when it's more fleshed out. If I'm going to play a vampire, I'll play what I know rather than something else for now. And then when it comes into its own, I'll assess it at its time. And like I say, of course, social media wasn't what it is now, and interviewers and developers or commentary exploring and educating us just wasn't available. And I started alluding to this earlier, but the mid-2000s also saw a slump in role-playing games. Even the mighty D&D was knocked off the perch as a best-selling role-playing game, for example. I have been best-selling role-playing game forever. People started doing a lot more online games. World of Warcraft, for example. I didn't do online games, so I couldn't... I'm assuming it was World of Warcraft. That seemed to be massive, but... anyway, cracking on. And this came about the worst time for a reboot of the World of Darkness. So from like the late 90s into the early aughts, it was bestseller Dungeons & Dragons, second place World of Darkness. Consistently, consistently, consistently. So you rebooted at a time when the industry went through a load of big changes. D&D was knocked off its perch by Pathfinder because I think they fluffed an edition. I'm not a D&D, I haven't played D&D for years. Played AD&D. It shows my age a bit, back in the mid-90s. I think they did an edition which fluffed it a bit, and Pathfinder took over its mantle, and World of Darkness just disappeared from the top five lists. So this game was time for reboot World of Darkness, and a halt and restart just failed to pick momentum when other entertainment were gaining momentum. I said before, if you look at live role playing, Mind's Eye Theatre, as your fan base, as your player group, you've got them kind of in a weird limbo at a time when there's new media being really fresh and exciting. You know, you're going to lose customers. And actually CCP, which were the EVE Online guys that bought White Wolf and wanted to create like a massive multiplayer online World of Darkness game, the fact that they bought it, the company, basically for their IP for computer games, shows the impact that online gaming was having on the industry back then. So that's my thoughts on a lot of the missteps that White Wolf made when they rebooted the World of Darkness. Now, my story continues, though. It was about 2008, 2009 when I came back to Requiem and role-playing. By that time, Requiem was pretty good, solid set of game books. I said before, I'm collecting them right now. However, I was mainly doing LARP, and Requiem and LARP was missing something. Requiem had being written as a great storyteller toolbox. And actually, if you were just running one domain, your own game, even like with LARP, Requiem could probably do what you wanted it to do. But I'd gone back to the Camarilla. I really like that big linked set of games, take my character around. And Requiem just missed that thing of having that big broader organizations like the Camarilla, like the Sabbat, like the Anarchs. So it always felt like it was missing something compared to what we had in the past. And actually people started trying to play the clans like they had in the Masquerade. Covenants kind of became like a bit like it was in the Masquerade, not how it was written. So it tried to look and feel like the Masquerade, but it wasn't. And Requiem just never really grabbed that as well. So over the late aughts into the early teens, I think live role playing, a lot of it collapses. Stuff that's successful tends to be the masquerade stuff that's carried on existing. I know down south in England, the By Night Studios, I don't think it's not By Night Studios, but there's like By Night Games look really well. They were always quite solid, like say, independent games scattered around. It's a real shame, like I say, because Requiem, there's a lot of power in the Requiem brand. And actually having the big daddy of all vampires, Dracula, floating around as a character, and I just feel White Wolf just wasn't in the best place to capitalize on it. And all the other business decisions that people are making. Don't get me started talking about people who run companies thinking they know everything because they've maybe had a bit of good luck. But anyway, that's another completely new topic. I'll stay on topic because I'm almost finished. Let's just get finished. Don't go off on a rant. So that ultimately my perspective on it. Why Requiem never had the bite that Masquerade had in terms of what was happening at the time. However, in terms of a game about vampires, in my opinion, Requiem is fantastic. And if you've not checked out Requiem and give it a look, I'll do some videos talking about the top bits of Requiem. But if you've not had a look at Requiem and you like games about vampires, I presume you do because you've watched so much of this so far, give it a look. If you've got any questions, give me a shout. If you lived through that period, I'd be really interested to hear your perspective on things as well. Everybody's got a different story. Everybody connects with the World of Darkness in a different way. World of Darkness means a load of different things to different people, and nobody's got the right perspective on it. Ultimately, the right perspective on it is your perspective. But anyway, thanks for watching. I look forward to chatting to you again, and I hope you're having a great time doing whatever you're doing at the moment. Miniatures, role playing, playing on the computer, getting out and walking. I just hope it's all working for you. But anyway, I'll see you again in another video. Look forward to chatting to you. I'll see you. Bye for now.